Mike's in there taking a dump. We should bust in.
Let's bust on this dude.
What the hell, man?
What you doing in here?
Reading a training book.
Don't put the camera on me.
Welcome to Barbell Shrugged. I'm Mike Bledsoe here with Doug Larson and Chris Moore.
Great.
With CTP filming, of course. Today we're going to be talking about the books that you should read before you start training ever.
Are we nerding out?
Yeah, we're going to get into some basic nerdiness.
This is one thing we hear all the time is, what kind of books, man?
Yeah, so we get a lot of questions like, what's the first book?
What's the first book I should buy?
A lot of people are like, well, what's the first book I should read?
And that's a tough question.
Well, it's hard to say, you know what I'm saying? Yeah. So we all picked out 10 books together. Is it 10? Top 10 books.
10-ish.
Yeah,
these are the top ones.
So we said this is the first 10-ish books you should read if you're doing any training whatsoever. But before we get into that, I want you to go to barbellshrug.com, sign up for the newsletter, so we can inform you of all the cool stuff going on.
What do they get when they sign for the newsletter?
They get the 8 snatch mistakes. Those 8 things that you're probably doing that are keeping you from hitting new PRs.
I'm hitting huge PRs, bro.
Now you've said that, we can never not use that video.
Yeah.
It's on video forever.
Speaking of upcoming events, this weekend, we're going to be interviewing Brian Mackenzie at Faction Strength Conditioning. What was that? The 21st of September, we'll be interviewing Brian.
Whatever that Saturday is, yeah.
Yeah, September.
I don't look at calendars, man. Calendars are for the weak-minded.
Doug never knows what day it is.
I show up where I'm supposed to be.
September 21st, we'll be interviewing him at 7 p.m. at Faction Strength Conditioning. If you go to barbellshrug.com, you can register for that by just clicking on events, and it'll be obvious. You'll get all the information there. All right, let's roll into the books. All right.
Cue intense book music. books, explosions.
Yeah, so we were a little concerned. Mostly Chris. Chris was extremely concerned. This was not going to...
Extremely is not fair.
We got to make sure this isn't going to be boring. So what we're going to do is we're going to talk a lot about nothing. And then bring up books here and there. I'm kidding, of course.
No, books are actually sexy and cool. So everybody likes books if you're a smart person. And we all smart people listening to this show for sure.
Yeah, no dummies listening to this show.
That's not a joke.
All right, so what we're going to do...
You're going to read your favorite passage?
We actually had...
From the Tome of Endurance, chapter 1, verse 4.
Yeah, this is...
I say unto you.
I'm going to pump Brian McKenzie's tires right here on the front end. No. Doug actually brought this up as a really good point because we had a really hard time figuring out which books we should introduce and what order and how we should go about it. But we kind of all agreed on what should be read first. So, and the reason being is, if you look here, if you're listening on iTunes, you don't get to...
You're screwed.
You don't get to see this. But I'm opening up a piece of Brian McKenzie's book. What was it? Power, Speed, Endurance.
Pieces are called chapters.
Oh. Well, if you read books, you would know that, but yeah. I don't. So, right here he's got, you know, LSD versus CrossFit endurance, and the old way of training is, you know, long, slow distance. That'd be like the old way of endurance training,
road work.
You know, you do the volume first. You know, you do a lot of running,
by buying your $200 pair of shoes. You got fitted to your fat feet at the local running
place.
You get all your preparations in place to start this running.
Yeah, so like, start practicing a lot. You know, that's kind of like the thing that most people do in any sport that they pick up or activity. Yeah. Just do more of it and you'll get better.
You'll be fine.
Yeah. Then you add the intensity. That's when you try to go harder or faster or lift more. It'll happen after you've been practicing for a while.
And you just keep doing that forever until you die, right?
Yeah.
Keep getting better and better until you die.
Reminder, this is the old way. And then the last thing you do is work on the skills. So this is this is like a mentality that a lot of people, I think this is a, the reason this is pointed out is because this is what people want to do. They want to do the volume first. Then they're like, oh, well, maybe I should worry about skill. And that happens a lot of times after they got hurt. You know, the only time they want to add that skill training is, all right, this has happened to me. So I'm not special. I think it's probably happened to everyone in this room. Mm-hmm. So like, we get all excited. We want to train. We want to get better. We're doing the volume. We start adding intensity. And then we get hurt and we're like, oh, maybe we should work on, you know, actually doing it well. Or building up some symmetry.
You left out the in-between part. The crippling depression once you get hurt and you realize you don't know what the fuck you're doing. You left all that. You skipped right over that.
Sorry. So,
that's a key part of the phase, though.
It is.
Like,
it
you need that to be emotionally motivated to actually take
Michelle
drills
said as much,
and skills and technique seriously.
Yeah, you
certain amount of pain is necessary.
Part of learning, man. You got to have a really strong emotional connection to that thing that happened for you to actually make change a lot of times. For some, more than others. So what Brian also, he suggests here right next to that is the CrossFit endurance way, which I would say is what is how every coach should approach any type of training, not just endurance, which is first skills and drills, you know, your technique, then intensity, and then the stamina, the volume-based training.
I agree with that, man.
Yeah, you want to get really good at something and then add volume. You don't want to add fitness to dysfunction, which actually is something that one of my books talks about.
We're gonna,
conveniently.
Wait your turn, Doug.
We're going to get into that. So, and the reason I bring that up on the very front end of the show is because this is why we're going to introduce the books in the order in which we're going to introduce them. So a lot of people want to know more about program design. Like, oh, because, you know, when you listen to coaches, a lot of times they don't talk about movement. You know, you'll find some coaches, all they talk about is movement, and other coaches talk only about program design. And honestly, it is a balance of those two things. But what most people, if they start hitting me up with program design questions, mm-hmm. and I start asking them or watching their movement, it becomes apparent to me really quick that they don't have a program design issue. They have a movement issue. Any good coach that's been around for a long time is going to agree with me on that one. No one's going to go, well, no, it could be the program. So, unless, of course, you're doing too much.
But yeah, the program is just one component of the whole deal. Like these other key things must be there before the other thing becomes something you start manipulating with. It's like if you start fiddling with your car engine before you know what is broke, you just mess all the other things up. You got to understand all the fundamentals, then move on to the tweaking of all these variables.
Yeah.
It is that's just a beautiful way of phrasing it. Just hit the priorities first. Everybody knows that's important when you hear it, but in practice, you go, oh, that's why, because I can screw myself up.
Yeah, if you have a loose wobbly tire on your car, no amount of driving skills or driving a certain speed for a certain distance is going to fix that wobbly tire. It's going to break.
And then it's also
you got to fix the tire first. You got to fix your technique.
Really analogy.
You got to fix your technique, and then you can add volume.
God, I love you, Doug. I love all the analogies and into the weeds you go. But it's true. Like you could spend. Oh, I guess I need to drive this car better. Yeah, I'll spend $1,000.
Now we're going in the weeds.
I'll spend $1,000 on. Driving courses, so I get better at dealing with this car that has a flat tire, or just pay $50 to fix a fucking flat tire. It's there the same thing, man.
Cool. Perfect, yeah. So I'm going to introduce a couple books first. So we each tried to pick out three. Doug got greedy and picked out four.
Greedy.
Bastard.
Smart and greedy.
He said it was for you guys, you know, whatever.
Very customer focused.
All right, so I would say, the first book, actually, I would not say power, speed, endurance. I would say the very first book is Olympic Weightlifting. And some people may go, hey.
By who?
Hey.
Say everything about the book so people
you
know.
You want people to read about Olympic Weightlifting because I'm biased. Yeah, I might be a little bit biased. So, I really do believe you're more likely to hurt yourself doing this stuff wrong than a lot of other things. So Olympic Weightlifting by Greg Everett. We will actually be podcasting with him in a few weeks. Out in California, which is going to be super cool because I've been following him for a long time and I've actually never met him. But
you like Greg.
Yes. But I think most coaches in the United States would say that this is the best book if you want to learn about weightlifting. It's very movement oriented. You know, it starts off with just a squat. And then the program design aspect of this book is very minimal. You know, he has a lot of examples in the back of programs. As far as like the explanations for program design, it's really simple. And if you're just starting, it's the perfect amount of information. It's the perfect amount of movement information, which is almost all movement. And then a little bit of program design, some stuff to help you out. examples of good beginner programs and advanced programs, just so you know what you're looking at when you look at a program. So that, I would say that one works really, really well for people who are wanting to get stronger. And then the second thing, I do like Power, Speed, Endurance by Brian Mackenzie. I cannot claim to have read it word for word, front to back. I went and got CrossFit Endurance certified a while back, and it was a really great certification. Really enjoyed it. And one of the things that I really learned there, and the thing you're going to see in this book a lot, I do use this book as a resource, is Brian is super on top of really focusing on movement first. And I think if you listen to him talk about anything, he's going to talk about positions. And having been a weightlifter, and then I go to this endurance thing, and I'm thinking, all right, running, cycling, swimming, you know, maybe kettlebell swings, pull-ups. A lot, you know, yeah, it's like weightlifting, using your hips and stuff like that. But with weightlifting, I'm like, it's all about positions. If you can't get in a position, you're wrong, period. And it really opened my eyes when I went to the endurance cert, and then this book is going to emphasize that a lot, is positions during other activities that aren't weightlifting. So I think there's a large emphasis on that with a barbell. But hey, you need to be in certain positions when you're running. Mm-hmm. If you miss those positions, you're wrong. You're going to get hurt, you know, so on and so forth.
It's like a cold mathematics. If you're at a position, there is no like qualitative interpretation, artistic angle. No, if you're out of position in weightlifting, the laws of physics dictate that you are not going to be what you could have been, because it's mechanically, you can't move the right way. That's something, I guess, if there's one lesson I've learned personally in my life this year, it's one reason why I really pay attention to what Bron and Kelly or Greg would say, is like a position is really way more important than I ever dreamed it could be.
Paramount, yeah.
In my paddling background, that's less of a thing. People don't really talk about position all that much. It's like whatever
they
did.
They talk about technique, but they never really get into the details. Yeah. They go, yeah, there's a lot of technique.
It's
and
more
that's
like,
it.
It's a dangerous thing. Like whatever it takes for you to get more out of your body now, that's what you do. If you squat 50 pounds more at this next meet, no matter how you did it, no matter what the long-term consequence, no matter if it is not the best thing you could do, if it makes you do more now, it's kind of like we're running. Whatever made you run faster now, great. Well, if it gives you shin splints or ruins your long-term health and fitness, not great. But it takes a while sometimes to get that practical lesson sort of to accept it.
Yeah.
No one really says this quite this way, so maybe this will make sense for some people. Basically, what good position and good technique really means is that you're in a position where your muscles are absorbing the force and the impact of the position, and your passive tissues, like your tendons and your ligaments and the bones to some extent, those aren't the things that are absorbing the forces. Your muscles absorb those forces, and they get sore, but they have a very good capacity to recover and then grow bigger and stronger, which is why we all lift weights. Yeah. And so putting them under stress and having them absorb that stress and then adapting very quickly within a day or two and growing bigger and stronger is what you want. But if you're out of position, your muscles aren't necessarily taking this all of the stress, and the joint, the ligaments, the tendons, and again, even the bones to some extent are taking the stress. An example of the bones taking the stress would be like developing bone spurs. Your bone will adapt to the stress, right?
Like my elbow.
And they, since your ligaments and your tendons don't adapt and recover as quickly as your muscles do, they'll tear a little bit, and then that tear won't repair, and then they'll tear a little more next time, and then that tear won't repair, and then they'll tear a little more, and eventually tear will tear all the way.
Snap
and now
off.
And now you've torn something. You've torn your ACL, right, or you've torn your Achilles, or what
rarely
have you.
Is it like a one event. It was a cumulative effect.
And now you got a reason to be fucking bummed.
And that's maybe I should go back a little bit and talk. You know, I was talking about how I felt like weightlifting, you should focus on those positions first before maybe running or kettlebell swings or pull-ups, but potentially like running, some of those sports where there's a lot of repetition could potentially be more dangerous than, say, getting in the wrong position for a snatch, because there's so much repetition involved. And then in addition to that, because there's so much repetition involved, there's so much opportunity to practice wrong. So if you're getting bad positions really frequently, not only are you putting up, you know, those tissues in danger, but you're also building up these poor motor patterns. So every rep you do wrong, you have to do two reps to make it right, you know.
On those kettlebell swings or your 500 reps of bodyweight squats, you can't really feel what's going wrong. But if you snatch one That's rep true. Wrong, you feel immediately you fucked up. It wasn't as efficient. It's like it's just a cold, hard,
it's completely obvious.
Objective teacher. Look, you didn't move right, man. Mm-hmm. Yeah. You swing a kettlebell 8,000 times, like you just said, you wear things out before you even knew you were wearing things out. Mm-hmm. And you ingrain a pattern true. That you can't even yeah. tell until you watch video yourself snatch and you realize, wow, that is never going to get fixed.
That's why it's hard sometimes with new people to convince them that technique is important and to get them to slow down on their workout because they want to get their heart rate through the roof and feel like they got a good workout because they got right. really tired and they don't focus on their technique because the effect of having painful or achy joints isn't going to show up for months or years down the road.
Or that night when they're laying in bed.
Well, if someone's brand spanking new, they blame it on
something else, though. They're like, oh, working out is not good for me.
Yeah, but that's usually a cumulative effect, too, from years of doing something else. Like, for someone who's brand spanking new, they can do things horrible the first day, walk home, and they feel fine.
You have a lot of those type of nights, don't you? Staring at the ceiling and you're thinking, who am I? What am I? Where am I going? What am I doing?
I was having this conversation with somebody yesterday. I was like, or maybe this morning. I can't keep up anymore. But
shit, man.
Yeah, it's like, I can't sleep anywhere but on my back. When I was younger, I slept on my belly, hands off by my side, and I was just like, my head was cranked to the side.
You wake up now, like, oh, Jesus.
But now,
what did I do to myself?
But now, I like, if I wake up on my side, I'm like, oh, my shoulder is killing me. So I gotta lay on my back. All right, we're gonna.
we're moving, off the topic of books.
Definitely off the topic of books. So, Olympic Weightlifting by Greg Everett, then Power Speed Endurance by Brian Mackenzie.
What's the third one?
Well, we'll bring the third one up later because that's about programming specifically. Yes, so I want to move over, you know, stay on the movement side of things because this is definitely paramount. We've made that
we
apparent. So anyways.
we paramountly made that apparent exactly. in a paramount way.
Doug went out and got the book Becoming a Supple Leopard by Dr. Kelly Starrett. Who? We will actually be interviewing soon.
It's an amazing book. It's the first time I've actually seen the hard copy. I've only seen a PDF preview thing before, and it's excellently done. I give him a lot of credit, man.
I actually read this whole book cover to cover on iBooks. So,
how long was that?
You know, it was like 1,000 pages on iBooks.
Yeah.
Doug
yeah.
is also a guy who will go to the beach, take a kinesiology textbook, and read that
to unwind.
Yeah. True story. I actually read this whole textbook cover to cover while I was in Australia on vacation, but that was the second time I read it.
You know, just a little light reading about the musculoskeletal system and kinesiology.
Right, so we'll get in that
you
in
know,
a second. So,
light reading.
A romantic tale.
Here, basically what I put together here was a total package for movement and technique. So this is probably the first thing that you should read. And Kelly will help you really understand movement. If you've watched Mobility Wad, then you understand Kelly really knows what he's talking about with regard to movement. Basically what he did was he put together...
Talking to your microphone, Doug. Jeez.
He basically put together... I got excited. all the information that he has on all of his Mobility Wad videos, and he appropriately organized it and categorized everything and put it together into one comprehensive book. So if you are looking to just, especially as a coach, looking to figure out, you know, how to fix someone's shoulder mobility, it's all put into the shoulder chapter. Like, it's all categorized mm-hmm. by movement or movement inefficiency, rather. So
yeah, it's kind of laid out like a textbook, but you can immediately tell that it flows way better than a textbook you've ever seen. Like, it's practical, heavily practical.
Yeah, it's very easy to follow. You don't have to be a movement expert to understand the book. He breaks it down and makes it where you don't have to be a physical therapist like he is to understand what he's saying.
Yeah, one thing before we move on, I want to explain this real quick. Is the two books I mentioned are sport-specific movement books.
Yeah.
So it's being able to move well doing CrossFit-type stuff, weightlifting-type stuff, endurance-type stuff, you know, moving in a sport. And then what Doug's going into are books that are good just for, like, good movement as a human being. These aren't as sport-specific, and this is more about, like, making sure your joints are staying healthy and stuff like that.
Some would argue there's not much of a difference, though.
Yeah.
There shouldn't be.
There shouldn't be much of a difference, really.
In an ideal world, you would probably start over here, but people aren't going to have the patience, so they should be over here.
Right. I've heard someone describe intelligence as the ability to make finer distinctions. So it's kind of the same thing, but the more and more you get into it, and the more you learn about this type of thing, they start to become very, very different as an expert. But if you're just starting off, you can think of it all kind of as the same thing. So anyway, if you are brand spanking new, you should definitely read this first. And then if you want to make these books make sense and you want the details of of movement and why these things are the way they are. Then
and
probably
for those of you listening, he's talking about Supple, Leopard, Power, Speed, Endurance, and Olympic Weightlifting, the books we've covered so far.
The first three books we've already covered. What I find with a lot of CrossFit coaches is that they're super motivated. They do some CrossFit, and then they decide, I'm just going to quit my job, and I'm going to be a CrossFit coach. And that's the way it is in a lot of cases, and they don't really have an academic background necessarily or a very strength and conditioning non-CrossFit background. And they haven't really read anatomy and physiology books. So they have a lot of kind of holes in their game. They have a lot of pieces they know really well, but there's a lot of things where they don't know really well. They read some blogs and they watch some videos and they got all these pieces, but since they haven't read kind of, you know, cover to cover some textbooks that fill in a whole topic comprehensively, they have these little gaps. So if you want to be able to kind of be on the level of a guy like Kelly Starrett, then you got to know at least the basics of anatomy, at least like bones and muscles and where they attach and why they work the way they work. And more specifically, if one muscle is not working very well, what happens? How do you compensate? Which is basically what bad technique is. If your knees dive in on a squat, you're compensating for some reason. Something's not working the way it's supposed to be working, and so your knees are diving in as a result of something else not working. It's usually something upstream or downstream, as Kelly usually says. It's a mobility issue or it's a motor control issue, which basically means that it's a lack of another muscle's ability to contract. It's not contracting like it should, and so the joints are kind of moving out of place.
That's a good point, man. Like, so, the reason why Kelly sounds so comfortable and common sense is because he has mastered the detail and he can translate that into a language you can hear. So if you only take the high level view, you won't get that depth. You just can't get the depth.
Right. And so reading a regular anatomy book, you'd read it and you'd be like, oh yeah, I mean, I'm back in school, I'm memorizing these words and I'm just doing it because I'm supposed to, but you don't really know why you're doing what you're doing. So that's why you're going to read these books first.
You just described every physician.
You're going to read these books first and you're going to practice, you know, CrossFit on your own. You're going to train. And then once you have some experience and you've read these other books, then these books start to make sense. So what I want you to do is read this kinesiology text by Newman, and it basically takes anatomy and it makes it make sense in the context of movement. It lets you know, you know, if it's talking about biceps, it lets you know why biceps are important, not just for doing things like curls, but things like deadlifts.
Or things like flexing your guns.
Oh, yeah.
So just right. So everybody, Newman, the book again, Doug, Kinesiology of the Musculoskeletal System, Foundations for Physical Rehabilitation.
Yeah, probably the best kinesiology book
that's
on the market.
Right? PT Bible kind of thing right there?
This is probably one of the first textbooks you would read in PT school, yes. Mm-hmm. Kinesiology is a science of human movement, if you didn't know that. So that's very, very good. Another movement book is called Movement, and that's by Gray Cook, who's also a physical therapist. This is a guy that came up with the functional movement screen, which there's pros and cons to the functional movement screen, again, depending on if you're actually an expert and you're a physical therapist and whether you need to have this little system to kind of tell you what to do. That's debate in the physical therapy world, but anyway, this book basically goes over the joint by joint concept and kind of tells you which joints are supposed to be mobile, which joints are supposed to be stable, and how to know where you need more mobility. You know, like the old school concept of like reaching down and touching your toes and just kind of stretching everything on the back of you. You know, stretching your hamstrings, and you're stretching your hips, and you're stretching your low back, and you're kind of stretching everything together. Is that a good thing? Is that a bad thing? Should I stretch my low back? Should I not stretch my low back? Why is that good? Why is that not good? He lays out a very comprehensive framework to let you know where you actually need more mobility and where you actually need to not get more mobility, where you actually want to train those joints to not move, which is what stability is. Stability means not moving in the presence of potential change. It means you could move, but you're strong enough not to. And some joints are like that. Some joints you don't want to move. You want your knee to bend, of course, but you don't want your knee to twist. You don't want your knee to bend sideways because that's, you know, that's you breaking your knee.
I tried that
so
once.
Didn't work out too good, no.
Right. So that's a really obvious example. But if there's a bunch of not so obvious examples all over the rest of your whole body that he points out in this book and how to make sure that you're moving in the right spots and you're moving with good technique, and he lays out a very easy to follow like I said, framework or kind of a template for how to think about your entire body, where it's a comprehensive system, and you're not just thinking about one joint here and one joint there. It's your body's a comprehensive system, and so if you're looking to get a systems approach to training, then movement by Gray Cook is very, very good. That was kind of an abstract explanation of that, but
it was the same reason why you don't take a isolated view towards training. You don't think I need my arms aren't my legs aren't strong enough. I'd do a bunch of leg presses. Mm-hmm. Same thing. That's why you don't go, well, my shoulder's stiff. I'll stretch my shoulder. Mm-hmm. That might not be the problem, man. You're not operating as these unique, discrete segments sort of stapled together. Everything is tied together in a very complex way.
Right. If you're brand new to training and you come in, you're like, I think my little back's been hurting or my shoulder's been hurting, and then I watch you move and I come back and I say, well, you got really immobile ankles and it's putting you out of position, and then your shoulder or your low back is the thing that's taking the stress because your ankle's not working. That's a hard thing to swallow for someone who's brand new. They're like,
but my shoulder's
hurting.
Why
are you talking about my ankles or
you don't,
whatever?
You don't get it, Doug. My shoulder hurts.
I'm gonna try an analogy. Yeah. It might fail.
Careful.
I'm ready.
All right. I would love it. Come on.
It's probably gonna suck now that I've said this.
You built it up.
It's a car analogy. All right.
Ready.
All right. Following you so far.
All right. I'm gonna break it down super simple.
Okay.
So your alignment's out.
Yeah.
So what the person usually wants to do, mm-hmm. if your alignment's messed up, that means like your steering wheel might be at a quarter, right?
Yeah.
Instead of straight up and down if you're trying to go straight.
Yep.
So it'd be the same as trying to just go to the mechanic and saying, hey, make my steering wheel go up and down. Don't worry about the alignment. Same thing.
Steering wheels don't go up and down, though. You lost me. Steering wheels rotate.
Exactly. No.
See how wrong you were?
You don't know anything about cars.
I got you.
What I mean by if you're driving straight, then the steering wheel is straight.
I think you just Bill Clinton to me. See? That's how confused you were. That's why you need my help. All right. I got you.
So Greg Cook's book, Movement, like I said, outlines that, the kind of overall template. Then finally, muscles, testing, and function with posture and pain. This is kind of like one of the Bibles of physical therapy. I think it was written like in the 50s. And a lot of the physical therapy texts that are out there today kind of...
The 50s? I didn't realize it was that old.
Are human bodies the same now as they were then?
Have you seen the pictures in this thing? They're like... They're fantastic. They're like all like 1940s and 50s pictures.
That makes it way
they're all
more
black and white.
That makes it way more interesting. So I
but why this book is so fantastic is again with the concept of compensation is basically if you have one part that's not working, it's going to cause some problem somewhere else. So an easy example is if I have like super short hip flexors and the muscles in front of my hips right here, if they're shortened, it's going to pull me forward like this. Right, it pulled these two points together. It pulled my pelvis basically towards my leg. It rolled my pelvis forward. Now I have a hyperextended back. So I might have back pain as an example because
his butt looks good.
That's right. I might have back pain here. My back might be achy because it's hyperextended all the time. And so I'm thinking, I need to stretch my back. I need to fix my back. I need more back exercises. I need a stronger back. I get all these questions all the time, right? And then you find out, oh, well, if you could just lengthen your hip flexors and pull yourself out of that forward tilt of your pelvis, then your back won't be hyperextended constantly. and then your back would start to feel better. And so this book lays out a bunch of examples just like that and shows you how to fix a lot of those common problems that if you're brand new, aren't as intuitive as you would hope they would be.
See, so you should have been at that doctor's office in Jackson, Tennessee. If you remember,
okay,
about a couple months ago,
the doctor said, I know what you're going to say.
Yeah.
I'll let you do it.
Yeah, yeah. The doc woman goes in, got lower back pain.
Oh, right. All right, got you.
Don't do this.
He told her diagnosis was ghetto booty.
Did he write that down like in the notes? And dude, he told that to her face,
I don't know.
Right?
That was in the newspaper. It was in the newspaper. Then it was on all these different, you know, the 5 o'clock news it was on. It was,
I'm pretty sure
that guy got fired or sued
or
something.
I give you points for trying to identify and communicate with your patients, but don't. Especially if it's an African-American lady, don't say things like ghetto booty to you.
Right.
Not a good idea.
Bad mistake. But I was going to say, Doug, this is from the 50s and it's great. We should go back and study like, even for our own amusement, like Leonardo da Vinci's studies of the human body and form and function. That would be kind of interesting maybe. Like what original insights for the first guy who's like, how does your body how's all this actually linked together, and how's it flow, and how's it, I got an idea, I'll draw this Vitruvian man. This seems to make it make sense to me. We should go back and look at that. It'd be interesting. Not to really study it hard, but that's where it all sort of began, I guess.
And one thing Doug was talking about beforehand, I don't want him to forget, but I also don't want to steal his thunder, so I'll give him credit, is he was saying, you know, Doug is definitely on the kinesiology side of things, he's the one that just loves nerd out on that kind of stuff. So one thing he said beforehand was read Supple Leopard, then read these more detailed books, and then come back and read Supple Leopard again, and it'll make more sense.
It will make a lot more sense,
and then
absolutely.
Take that a step further is do just that, and then come back and read the Olympic weightlifting and the power, speed, and endurance again, because then you'll zoom out a little bit more, and it'll apply specifically to what's happening in the gym. And to like your sports movements.
I think if you do that, you'll start seeing things as these guys see them.
Yes, like absolutely.
Yeah, I find that with pretty much every book that I've ever read more than once, especially this very basic text. Like I read this probably maybe 8 or 10 years ago, something like that. Like with the first time I read it, and then I went through, you know, the rest of my college career and the rest of graduate school, and had a lot more experience on the academic side of thing, but also in the training side of thing. I was much more experienced with training after, you know, 4 or 5 years, especially that's when I had started competing in weightlifting and really improved my weightlifting. And then I came back and read this again and had a whole new perspective on why everything I was learning in here was applicable to the real world. So every time I've ever reread something, I always read it from a new frame of mind, and everything makes sense in a totally different way than the first time I read it. So yeah, definitely do what Mike said. Read Supple Leopard, read these books, and then, you know, this will take you, you know, I don't know how long to read, a year, and then or if you're lucky, and then come back, and after a year,
if you're as smart as Doug,
a year of extra training experience and reading these books, Supple Leopard will make way more sense, and you'll get that much more out of it. And then do it again, go read a bunch of other stuff, and then come back and read Supple Leopard again, because this is a great resource. You should read it over and over
and
over
again. Maybe we should make that point, man. Like, look, Doug, when did you start reading this shit, Doug? When did you first read these books?
I mean, I've read stuff like this for a long time. I was super lucky that I had quality coach since I was about 15.
Even, we all know how spoiled you
this was. Actually, one of the first books that I ever tried to read when I was like 16.
I'll talk about that.
It was way overwhelming. So actually, let's go ahead and transfer over to you.
I was going to say, let's take a break and then we'll get to the program.
But no, I'll just say, let me close that point. Like, look, I know these are a lot of books, and if you're really eager to bloom as a CrossFit athlete, as a strength conditioning professional, as a athlete yourself, or whatever, you're going to feel a lot of pressure to try to get your head around all this, and that's a good thing. But understand that the guys who wrote this are 25 years deep into their experience or whatever.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
They sunk a decade of their life into school. They sunk another 5-10 years or whatever into mastering all that. This takes time to read that and to really have those moments, like Doug's saying, where you go, wow, dude, I get it. To have that moment, you got to work and earn that. So if it takes you, if it took you a year to get through Newman's book, to really go, I took my time, I read that the right way, that is fine. That is amazing.
Read it to learn it. Like, I used to read books to try to get through them, and now, like, you know, if it takes me a month to get through a book, so be it. I'm going to get as much out of it as I can.
I know it's really sexy to be able to say, yeah, I read Supple Leopard in a week, it was good, or a day. but honestly, if you don't remember, if you can't apply it, then what did you do? I mean, just put your ego on the back shelf. Take your time, man. Work through these things at a pace that works for you, so you can say, aha, motherfucker, I got it.
Yeah, I think going back and reading them a second time is good, too. I know there's some college courses I took where I was like, why am I learning this? I'm memorizing, especially kinesiology. It's like,
be honest,
this muscle is attached to this bone. I'm like, all right,
Michael, let's be honest.
Who cares?
You don't remember shit from college.
I didn't. What happened was I was, you know, got into coaching, and then I was like, you know, a year later, I'm like digging in through the boxes, pulling the books back out, going, oh, this hurts. Why? Or just identifying the muscle or something like that. You know what I mean? But real quick before we take a break, just want to mention Doug is a very big kinesiology nerd.
And that's a good thing.
You already mentioned that.
That's not disparaging.
He did. it's a compliment.
It is.
He did put together a product called a Maximum Mobility, which is in the Barbell Shrug store. So that is actually another resource. So Doug's read all these books a couple times. So if you want to like just get the highlights and get the stuff that's probably going to be super applicable to what you do, you might just want to pick up Maximum Mobility in addition to this stuff.
It really is. Maximum Mobility basically is a combination of this book and, to some extent, this book, although Kelly's book is way more than you're going to get in Maximum Mobility. And in all reality, he has a lot more stretches and specific things. But the benefit of Maximum Mobility is that just like this book, there's a lot of tests to see how much range of motion you actually have at all your joints. Most people think, I know I'm not very flexible, but what do I do about it? I got to stretch my hamstrings or whatever. But
it's a test retest type scenario,
right? And people say test retest all the time, and you can test retest your position, the position of a movement. But if you want to actually quantify how much range of motion you have at each one of your joints, there's a lot of easy ways to do that, and that's what is for the most part taught in this book. It's anatomy text,
man,
plus
so good.
Testing range of motion. So
until you measure, so it,
I got a lot out of this for maximum mobility specifically.
Yeah, the mistake people make with mobility is like, I stretched and okay, I got that out of the way. If you didn't measure it before and after, how do you know what you're doing is working? How do you progress? How do you get better at being in the right position? How the fuck do you know what you're doing?
True that, homie.
Measure something, man. Get some numbers to measure things with.
Numbers. They're important. All right, guys, let's take a break.
Take a break.
When we come back, we're going to talk about program design books.
You always got to believe that you can do it. I tell that to people. It might not happen this today. It might not happen this week. It might not happen next week. It might not even happen next year. But if you believe that it'll happen, you can do it. It will happen. It will. I know it will. I might not be the fastest. I might not be the most gymnasty out there, but I'll tell you what, I'm never going to stop. Ever stop believing in what I can do. No one can take that away from me.
All right, welcome back to Technique Wad. I'm Doug Larson with the Barbell Shrug Podcast, and these are a bunch of our faction athletes. They're going to be here for the demo portion of today's Technique Wad. Today we're talking about car pushing. It's basically just like pushing the prowler, but a lot more people have vehicles than prowlers. So what we're going to do today is we're going to talk a little bit about the technique behind it and kind of why you might want to use car pushing in your program, and maybe different intervals or different setups that you can develop workouts from. So technique number one, or point number one rather, this is just like pushing prowler. Like I said, you want to get as low as possible, arms locked out, and then you're just driving with your hips probably about the same level as your hands, elbows always locked out. And then you always have a driver in the driver's seat. Then you always have a driver in the driver's seat. They can steer and apply the brakes if needed. So my favorite ways to do car pushes is to do 100% full speed intervals for as long as you can tolerate. Maybe it takes you 30 seconds or a minute. And then you basically just rest until you feel totally fine. Maybe 3 minutes to 5 minutes as your rest interval. And then you can do that maybe 5 to 10 times total. If you're going 100% full speed and you're really putting out, then that should be all you need to get a really good workout, just like doing Airdyne sprints or pushing the prowler. 30 seconds, 60 seconds, 100% full speed is plenty of work to get you very tired and very fatigued and give you a good benefit from that. With the car, I actually like to do it with a group of people, which I think is more fun. So there's a variety of ways we could do that. If we take a couple of guys, one way I like to do this is just pick a distance. Say we're going around this building right here. It's a big building. Maybe it's 400 meters all the way around the building. We would just push the car for 10 second intervals where two people are pushing at the same time. And every 10 seconds, one person will filter out and then a new person will filter in. And you just rotate every 10 seconds for the entire time you're pushing the vehicle all the way around the whole building. So if we have one person kind of steering the car and hitting the brakes if necessary, no one's out here right now, this is a good spot for it, but someone or another vehicle could come and get in our way, so it's good to have someone to apply the brakes. So it'd look like this if we had you guys come over here, and you guys can just kind of line up on this side. So after 10 seconds, this guy's going to fall out, and this guy's going to scoot over, and then a new person's going to come in. And then, yeah, just go ahead and stand right there. And then after 10 more seconds, David will come out, she'll scoot over, and a new person will come in, and they're just going to rotate just like that every 10 seconds. So we'll start with you guys. It'll look like this. Every time I say rotate, you guys are gonna, you're gonna go out, you're gonna come over, and you're gonna come in. That make sense? Yep. Okay, so here we go. Ready? 1, 2, 3, push. Push as hard as you can. There you go. All right, now rotate, and you come in, you can go out. Ooh. And rotate. And rotate. There you go, rotate. There you go. Rotate. All right, go and take a break. All right, brakes. All right, very nice. So, he's so tired. Ooh. All right, so that's one way you can do it. With two people, it's pretty easy with a light vehicle. When I was growing up, we used to do this with a Suburban, and so it was a little bit heavier than my small Passat. But that's one way you can do it, is rotating many people through like that, and you can pick whatever distance you want. I'm going around these two buildings is about maybe a half mile, and so having five or six or more people is kind of nice for those longer distances. If you're all by yourself, or maybe you have like three people, then you might want to do short intervals with a longer rest break, and then he can just apply the brakes until you guys are feeling better. You can go every minute on the minute. You can break up the intervals however you'd like, but it's great conditioning overall. Just remember, always go 100% full speed when you're pushing. Rotate frequently, and it's a lot of fun. If you have more questions about anything, yeah, obviously have your car in neutral. If you have more questions about pushing the prowler or pushing the car or anaerobic type conditioning like this or interval training, you can always go to barbellshrug.com, click the Ask a Question tab at the top of the page, and we can do a technique wad about it in the future.
And we're back.
Hello.
Here with Doug Larson and Chris Moore.
Who are you people?
Doug gets pissed off every time.
God, like,
so unprofessional.
This is so unstructured.
All right, so we just got done talking a lot about movement because movement is paramount for the fifth time we mentioned it this episode.
It's paramount.
It's paramount.
It's so, paramountly paramount.
We're going to now talk about program design and books that are about programming. And I say, what do you got over there, Chris? Because I think what you have over there is kind of the more basic or the stuff for strength training specifically.
Yeah, I mean that's my world. If Doug geeks out on mobility and functional, I guess I would geek out on talking strength. It's my bag, baby. Specifically like powerlifting background, a strongman type stuff. But so I have two books. I have very, very few. Like training specific or nutrition specific books on my bookshelf. Mostly it's like some philosophy and this, that, and the other, because I draw ideas from there and link them up with what I'm doing. But I've got these two, man. The first one Doug pointed out, he tried to read the Mel Siff's book, Super Training. There's been a lot of additions to this. When did you, like when you're 15?
That was like the end of high school.
Yeah, so.
That was a book that my strength coach had just sitting around when I was training at his house in high school.
He probably couldn't even read it through. This is, okay, for super, my first reading.
No one's ever read it.
No one's, it's just thick.
Kind of like the Encyclopedia of Weightlifting. Yeah, I've read that. Yeah,
right. So Mel was a really.
You browse through it.
Mel was a really genius guy. I guess he's been passed away now
he has a couple years now.
Maybe like early 2000s or something.
Yeah.
Bright guy, was really tuned into all the research that came out of the former Soviet Union, which on its own is maybe a little oversold, because when you hear a Russian guy say, what you must do is depress the functional capacity of the organism. It sounds a lot sexier than saying, get in shape, asshole. So that is a little bit baked in. So the language is sometimes, I would say, a little complicated. I first read this book when I was in undergrad. So maybe like that second year course where you take like advanced strength theory and all that. I got into this because it has a lot of that in it. Mm-hmm. So it's a lot of physiology, a lot of theoretical mapping out of stresses you would experience in training and how you would sequentially time those so you would get a certain effect. And that's when I first started seeing the real explanation for things like conjugate.
Yeah, you're gonna see that
periodization, all that kind of stuff.
Like, the Russians were the first one, or kind of the first ones. The text was coming out and saying like trying to time hormonal and
yeah. So dude,
responses
if you,
and stuff like that. Yeah.
If you got interest in getting as far into the weeds as you want to go and those angles, this book is exceptionally good at presenting just about. You can see all my former coffees. I think when I was in college, I spilled coffee all over this thing, and it still bears the marks. But it is super dense, super compact, with every kind of idea anybody could ever mention about how your body would react to strength training and how you should try to program it. Should you read it?
It is super dense. In fact, if you do read it, I bet you get more out of reading that book five times in a row than after reading almost any other strength training books.
I mean,
if you just read it five times in a row, you'd be a genius.
Yeah, here's the thing about these kind of books is that dense. Everything you could theorize, everything you could think about in terms of like muscle physiology, hormonal activation and effects from training, the way you would organize your training theory, all that shit is in here a lot. So like Doug said, if you had one book on that and you got this, you'd have everything.
A lot of other stuff is based off of those
it's
principles.
Super awesome, but man, it's like having a quantum mechanics textbook. It's like it's all in there. How you live your life better, how you coach better after that, shit, I don't know, man. That's gonna take the next for me, that took the next 15 years of my life.
If you look at any other book on programming and you look at the end for the references, super training is always referenced.
Yeah. No one who calls himself a serious strength coach is at least not really aware of what's in here and how it works out. Now, that said, if we're talking like what books do you start with, to some extent, Doug's strategy might be useful here. It might be very good for you to get a fundamental understanding and a very practical understanding. Then, like if I read this now, maybe I'd get a lot out of it. But, you know, we got busy days. Reading through this son of a bitch will take some time to sit down. Maybe I will. Maybe I'll take it upon myself to see what I can draw out of it. So that said, I guess sort of the more reasonable place to start for mastering programming stuff, one singular book, if I had to point to one, I point to Ripito's book. This is Practical Program for Strength Training. It's very similar, I think, in scope to Super Training in that Mark does a really good job. And also Lon Kilgore, I think, is a PhD. I don't know if he still works at is it Midwestern. What's that university down there? He's a Texas academic guy.
Yeah.
Maybe a professor of sports science and strength conditioning. So they teamed up with this book. It's really to the point, terse, no bullshit, as you would expect from anything that Mark is involved with. He's a very no bullshit kind of guy. And I, for that alone, you got to respect the dude, right? I mean, you got to respect it. For advanced weightlifting theory and movement like Greg would give you, this is probably not your book, but for a really awesome understanding, fundamental understanding of how your muscles work, how the hormones are working, and how from a beginner to an intermediate level, and maybe getting into even advanced stuff or advanced intermediate, how you would actually program to make the most out of, to manipulate those variables. That's, to do that in a book that's less than an inch thick is extraordinary. I think this is definitely a book I would recommend for people.
It's not going to be hard to get through either.
No, it's very welcoming. If you know, if you have an interest in this stuff, you will find this book very easy to get through. It makes sense. It's very much like you would see from Jim Wendler's stuff or you know, any practical, just good common sense. Like, here's how your muscle work. Here's how you manipulate that to make it stronger. So yeah. I can't recommend it more.
Yeah, everything Ripto does is very, very here. Just do this. It's very easy to
follow.
Simple. It's very, yeah. It's very real world.
And for educating and for getting people to understand some basic things, strength, great. For getting into the weeds about how we fix American weightlifting, not great, because straightforward approaches don't make sense in that context. That's why I would sort of stop that conversation.
Complicated problems need complicated answers.
Yeah, if you say, well, the reason why American weightlifters suck is because they're not strong enough, well, then you're getting a little past what this kind of mindset can get you. But for learning everything you need to know to understand strength and what your body's doing to make somebody stronger and to do it in a way that's reasonable and safe and with good mechanics, this book is great.
One thing I want to say about program design overall is what you're going to find is all the programs that work really well, they're all going to have a lot of similarities. You're going to kind of spot the same principles.
Yeah,
You say that book right there would kind of like give you the principles that you need to like operate from?
Yeah, it starts with a very just no bullshit perspective on here's good movement, here's the physiology, here's why a beginner shouldn't do that, here's why that no longer works for an intermediate athlete. It really walks you through these principles that are really, they're going to apply to anybody. To like the mathematics or the physics of strength training. You might get the same thing from other great texts. I'm not saying you can't, but you're getting everything you need to then go out and engage with people and start really building upon this. This gives you all you need. Then you can go back and read stuff like Super Training and get a really good, super detailed understanding of what you're talking about.
Yeah. I chose another book for program design. Because Chris got some really good stuff for strength training. As far as like conditioning, if it's your first book and you want to really understand how the different energy systems work in your body, I think Joel Jamison in the book Ultimate MMA Conditioning, he did a really good job of breaking down the different energy systems and how to train them. Not everything in there, as far as like, there's a lot of interval training and why and how it applies. A lot of it would be kind of tough to convert to CrossFit because it's very MMA oriented. You look at MMA athletes, the energy demands of an MMA athlete is kind of similar to CrossFit. You can make an argument for some CrossFit workouts are nothing like a fight, and that is true, but
except
for Fight Gone Bad. That's a joke.
CrossFit jokes are the best jokes.
But if you want like a good general explanation of basically how the body works, this is a great place to start. It'll give you some really good examples of how interval training should work and stuff like that. There's definitely a lot more. There's a lot of other things you could find some good interval-based training. But as far as like getting each piece of the pie, I would do that. And if you combine the strength training stuff, so Joel Jamison also covers some strength training stuff in here, but if you combine that with something you get from Ripito, I think you're going to be pretty well-rounded on the strength and conditioning knowledge.
Do we make a point that really you're reading this stuff because like this MMA book teaches you a lot, but of course you don't go into it looking to just photocopy this and staple it on to what you're doing. You're looking for the elegance and how it's put together and how that makes sense and why you would take that lesson then apply it to something.
Yeah, you got to be careful with this one too, because a lot of it's like no resistance. So you know, you can't just take like the intervals and just copy paste, because the intervals might be like you're just shadow boxing with no resistance, or you're running. You can't apply those same exact principles to like say if you're on an airdyne, or if you're rowing, or if you're doing thrusters. Things get changed up. It depends on how fast you're cycling the movement, how many muscle, you know, like if you're using your whole body to do it, or if it's just a, you know, there's just so many variables. There's a good place to start and start experimenting from. That's really the case with any of the programming stuff.
It is, and it, like just another word of caution, I say this often, but it bears repeating, that if you're interested in learning about getting your head around strength more, learn it and study it and see how it can fit with what you want to do and what you want to accomplish, and have help to do that, work with people to do that. But be careful when you do something like, I need to get stronger, let me take like Jim's excellent 531 programming for strength training, apply it to weightlifting, which is not necessarily appropriate, staple it on to my CrossFit programming.
Jim will tell you that.
Jim will say that. That's the whole point.
Yeah, Jim won't lie and say,
if you take anything that Mark writes or that this conditioning book, and you take it and you bolt it on to what you're doing, and you don't think it through, you don't understand it, you don't have your aha moments like Doug was saying. If you just stick it on to whatever you're doing without understanding what you're doing, you're not doing 531. You're not doing anything Greg would recommend. Now you're doing something you are concocting. This is an experiment you're going to learn about. This is not 531 anymore. This is not West Side or something Greg would have you do. You're now doing something new. You're mixing things that haven't been mixed this way. You're doing things that are risky. So take extreme caution when you take that approach. Learn about what you're doing and take your time and slowly introduce new things.
What I like to do is follow a program like to the T, and then find out what about that program you like, or the things that you saw really work.
Doing nothing else while you're doing it, right?
Right. Throw out the stuff that doesn't work, and then, you know, try someone else's stuff. And then when you run out of other people's stuff to do, you know, kind of like where I'm at and where a lot of coaches are at, is like, you know, you do 90% of the stuff that you know works. You know, I know that, you know, 9 times out of 10, if we do this type of training, we're going to get this kind of effect, you know, and you can't control for a lot of variables that someone might be doing, like eating and sleeping, all that.
And but, you've done like your rowing intervals, you know what kind of effect that is. And now you know how to mix them without destroying yourself.
But now, and so that now you start, but every coach, I think, if they want to advance, they got to start playing around with that 10%. You know, it's like, well, let's try this over here, you know. But you know, it takes a long time because each experiment's going to take months to see the result from.
I've heard a lot of people compare programming to being a chef or being a cook. First, you start off as a cook, you have no experience, you follow recipes, you follow someone else's programming.
You chop a lot of onions.
Yeah, eventually you learn how to kind of switch out ingredients or add a little more of this or a little less of this, and then down the line you can become a real chef and you can actually write your own recipes.
But first
you got to follow someone else's recipes. So follow someone else, another coach that you admire and respect, follow their workouts first, and then you can intelligently make some changes as you get more experience, and then eventually you can do your own programming or program for other people.
And all three of us standing in this room,
four of
at
us.
The table, because CTP is also standing, we've all chosen that coach, you know, at some point. We were like, we're going to just follow what they do, and you're always going to start with that person. You're going to like really listen to them and kind of do their type of program and really get into that. And then eventually you're going to start listening to other people too, and you'll start bringing that in. And then, you know, I know that Doug and I have talked about this. We've totally gotten away from that coach at some point, and you come back and forth a little bit. But
who are your coaches that you followed, or that you still have followed the most leading up till today?
As for CrossFit programming,
Who you kind of modeled after?
I would say
that you can make a recommendation to.
I would say OPT had a pretty big, as far as a lot of the CrossFit style program design. OPT had a lot of influence, and then also that'd be James Fitzgerald. And then for weightlifting, kind of, well, I had a weightlifting coach for about a year and a half who did a lot of program design with me. And then read was it Takano's book. I felt was fair. It was good. Now we're getting off in the weeds with other stuff.
Let it happen.
But anyway, who's talking about
Greg Everett? He has a great site with. I would say Greg Everett's probably the strongest influence on the weightlifting, just because he has so many he has like a million examples of programs, and each program is named appropriately. Like, mm-hmm. We're trying to get our back squat up this cycle, so on and so forth.
What about you? Who'd you follow and kind of model after when you were coming to where you are today? When you were younger and then more recently?
That depends, Doug. Can you help me know where I'm at now? I have no idea. I was gonna say, my case is really, you just got me thinking about it. It's really kind of bizarre in that when I really got serious about training, I had two influences, and they're both so different. On one hand, I was doing the things I was competing at. I was listening a lot to what Louis had to say about powerlifting and guys who were big name lifters in the sport at the time, which is quite natural. So I got a lot of really good cutting edge things. I got a lot of things that were unnecessary, a lot of shenanigans. As anybody who's listened to our podcast with Louis knows, it's a mixed bag, but he's a very kind, genius guy. Counterbalancing that was all the influence I was getting from the guys I was doing work with. So guys like Dr. Brian Schilling, Dr. Lauren Chu now. All that experience I got with John Garhammer, Dr. Michael Stone, Dr. John, all these are doctors. There's this weird gradient between great weightlifting knowledge that I personally wasn't doing. I was just observing firsthand and then trying to mix that in with this very bizarre circus atmosphere of powerlifting. That's where my weird ass perspective comes from, I guess. But yeah, it was guys like Mike Stone and John Garham doing great research and doing great books. And then there was this circus sideshow of the powerlifting world. That was my influences.
How about you, Doug?
It's a sharp gradient.
You're the last one left. He's gonna throw a wrench in and be like, I don't have any.
I don't have any. No, I'd say growing up, my strength coach growing up, his name was Mark Real, out of Real Performance up in Washington State. And he wrote all my programming for me when I was in high school and probably the early part of college before I started, like I said, kind of adding a little more of this and a little more of that and making little tweaks. And then eventually I started writing my own programming. After Mark, when I had moved away from my hometown and eventually when I moved to Memphis especially, I started following Eric Cressy pretty close. His style really, really kind of connects with me, especially because he's a shoulder guy and I got a little bit of a shoulder issue still. So I like looking at his stuff. So I'd say those two probably more so than anyone else.
Yeah. Cool. Let's wrap this up. What did you want to say before we left?
Does anyone want to make us a Wikipedia page? I feel like we should get a Wikipedia page. We can't make it ourselves. Is that right?
That's the rule.
How does Wikipedia know this?
I don't know, but it seems like a bad karma move if you write your own story and make it really flattering. And then people know you got to go in and edit it, and like then you get taken down a notch. Like, oh, I guess I was being a little too pat on my back here.
No, there was something else you wanted to bring up.
Oh, that we were talking about that last night. Remember that? You had been drinking.
I
was going to say was, we're talking about education right now and reading. Most people that are listening to this podcast, if you're listening to this podcast, you probably already have some training experience. You probably already enjoy CrossFit and whatnot. Maybe you compete. The point is to have some amount of balance between these three things. You want to balance learning, practicing, and doing. You don't want to just learn. You don't want to be the guy that reads surfing books and has never surfed in his life but knows everything about surfing.
Makes you an asshole professor.
Yeah, exactly. You don't want to be just academia and no practical experience, but you also don't want to be the guy that just lifts weights and doesn't know anything about energy systems or anything about movement and the physiology or the kinesiology behind things. You don't want to be the guy that just kind of never does anything and just only shows up on game day, so to speak, and only competes but never practices and never does any learning outside of the gym. So try to balance learning, practicing, and doing, and that's how you're going to improve the fastest and the most comprehensively, in my opinion.
Also, we brought a lot of books today. We decided earlier this week that we would do an episode on just resources in general, and we actually made I made a list of websites and blogs because mm-hmm. we all brought books, but we also had ideas of other resources as well. But yeah. If you guys would be interested in hearing more about maybe the websites that we follow, or the other books, maybe this is all about training today. We mm-hmm. basically covered movement and programming. If you're interested in maybe our favorite nutrition books or something like that, then just let us know.
Yeah, or events and conferences and seminars. We go to a lot of that stuff.
Yeah, the truth is that
I personally get the most out of seminars.
Look, I'm like trying to think somewhere. Right now, but yeah, going somewhere and being around people who have the same insights and have different experiences is how you really learn boots on the ground. Hearing people talk and seeing them express their passion. That's how books are great, but we all know the limitations of books. It's one-dimensional, it's dead, it's static, it sits on your shelf. It's great, but it's only one small way for you to learn.
Yeah, I find that some of the best ways that I learn from a book is reading it and then talking to somebody who kind of has read the book before or at least has knowledge about that topic.
Yeah.
And I say, hey, what do you think about these ideas that were brought up in this book? And they go, well, this is what I think, this is what I've experienced. And not only do I get to draw my own experiences, but maybe they have something unique that I didn't think about before.
We're all spoiled now. We can log on now to the great OPT resources, to guys like Greg, to all these coaches, and see them in real time post ideas. Like in CrossFit football is a good example. Ideas posted, here's a workout, here's everybody's results and what they thought about it. Mm-hmm. Going yeah. back years and years, like right now you can see all this. Like one of the limitations in sports science I always dealt with when I was in that world and talking with guys like Dr. Mike Stone, Dr. John Gunnheim, all these guys, all the data, it's kind of hard to get enough to kind of get that feeling like somebody tried this and here's what happened. It's a lot of theory and it's a lot of dated material maybe, and there's a lot of professors who don't look like they fucking have ever squatted 500 in their life. So how they know everything in Mel Siff's book, but like so what, man? You haven't really, when's the last time you trained? Well, I don't train anymore, I gotta write grants. It's like, yeah. You can see online right now all these amazing resources of people just playing it out and showing you, like, here's all these results. Here's how it works with people. Here's what these different kinds of people all think about it. That is amazing.
Yeah, the internet's allowed for things to move really fast when it comes to coaching because people can share information so much faster now.
And it's good for that, and it's really good for porn. Especially now we have iPads. Good Lord.
What was the new virtual reality thing you were talking about earlier?
Oh, shit, man.
Oculus Rift.
Oculus Rift. If you guys want to trip, because there's going to come a time when like you can just sit in a seminar with this thing on, and you're there with Kelly. That's going to happen, too. It's basically goggles that are really advanced. Spatial.
We still talking about porn? We talking about Kelly Starrett? Or both?
Kelly, we're going to talk about porn on the show when you come on. We'll see what you feel about that. But there's going to come a time when you just put this headset on and you're wherever you want to be learning what you want to learn. Now, Oculus Rift. Search Oculus Rift Roller Coaster on YouTube and you're going to see the future. And it's going to scare you kind of. The Matrix is real. It's going to have implications.
Sounds like an excellent
porn,
thing
for
to close
coaching,
out with.
For education, for everything. Wow, man. Good times to be alive.
Thanks for joining us.
Wikipedia.
Yeah.
Porn.
Thanks for joining us.
Barbell Shrug.
On this week's episode of Barbell Shrug. Don't forget, if you enjoyed this episode, go to iTunes, give us 5 stars, leave a comment, and go to barbellshrug.com and sign up for the newsletter so we can inform you of all the cool stuff that's coming up. Leave anything out, CTP? Good to go?
Good to go.
He's not even giving me nods. Frozen. He's not even giving me nods. What the hell?
You've upset him.
You know what it is? He's pretending like he's filming. He ran out of battery again.
What do I do with my hands?
That's what he does when he runs out of battery or memory. He just stands there and acts like he's filming. All right. I'll see you next time.
Thanks, guys.
Cheers.